Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper. The central government has requested the Supreme Court to grant permission to return the excess land which was acquired by the government near the disputed Ayodhya site. On the 6th of December 1992, radical Hindutva outfits brought down the Babri Masjid at Ayodhya, and this led to widespread communal riots across the country. This was an event which was a blot on Indian democracy, and the Ayodhya dispute has acquired not just religious and communal overtones but also political significance. The map given here shows the Babri Masjid site. The small yellow patch that you can see over here is the core disputed area, and this measures around 0.31 acres in dimension. And the current title dispute, which is being fought between multiple organizations at the Supreme Court, is related to the disputed area which is shown over here in the map. So the Ayodhya dispute is essentially a title dispute between few Hindutva organizations and the Sunni Waqf Board. And due to the communal nature of the dispute, the central government had acquired the land area which is adjacent to the disputed core area, and nearly 67.7 acres of land was taken over by the central government by passing the Ayodhya Act in 1993. This was done with the intention of maintaining communal harmony and the spirit of brotherhood. And this would also ensure that the other stakeholders will not carry out any activities in and around the disputed area which would lead to further communal tensions in the country. So since then, the government has taken possession of around 67.7 acres of land around the disputed Ayodhya site, and this map here marks the boundaries of the government acquired land in 1993. And right now the center has requested the Supreme Court to return this adjacent land, which is also termed as the superfluous land, that is the land which was acquired through the Ayodhya Act of 1993, and the center has shown its intentions to return the acquired land to the original owners. And this move of the central government is based on the 1994 judgment of the Supreme Court, wherein the Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court said that the government has complete discretion when it comes to deciding the extent of land area which should be awarded to the winning party with regard to the title dispute in order to give them access to the disputed site. This judgment came out through the Ismail Farooqi case, and this ruling has given discretionary powers to the center to decide the extent of land area which is awarded to the winning party in order to access the core disputed area. So right now the center is saying that this green patch of land is sufficient to be awarded to the winning party in order to access the core area, whereas the adjacent land can be returned to the original owners. So who are these original owners? A majority of the 67.7 acres of land which has been acquired by the center is owned by Hindutva organizations. Nearly 42 acres is owned by the Ram Janmabhoomi Nyas Trust. And that's the reason why legal experts and opposition parties are saying that the government is signaling to the Hindutva organizations that their demand to construct a Ram temple at the disputed site will be met by the government before the upcoming elections. And the reason why the center is requesting the Supreme Court for permission is that the Supreme Court had ordered all the parties to maintain status quo at the disputed site through its 2003 judgment. In 2002-2003, some Hindutva outfits had carried out a religious ceremony at the disputed site. They had carried out a Bhumi Puja for the construction of a temple, and the Supreme Court intervened in this issue and it prohibited any religious activity from being conducted in the disputed and the adjacent area. It had clearly said through the 2003 judgment that both the disputed area and the adjacent area, they are intrinsic to each other. So in this area which has been acquired by the government and in this area which is disputed, religious activities were prohibited and all the stakeholders were ordered by the Supreme Court to maintain status quo. Now let's take up the next article. The Chakma refugees have submitted a request to the Ministry of Home Affairs to grant citizenship status to the Chin refugees as well under the controversial Citizenship Amendment Bill. The Chakmas are a minority ethnic group and they are largely found in parts of Northeast India. They are found in states such as Arunachal Pradesh, Mizoram, etc. And they have migrated from East Pakistan and Bangladesh, where they have constantly faced religious persecution. The Chakmas, along with the Hajongs, were promised citizenship status by the government of India, and the process is underway to grant citizenship to these two refugee communities. But granting citizenship status to Chakmas and Hajongs has been resisted by a number of ethnic groups in the northeastern parts of India, such as the Mizos, the tribes of Arunachal Pradesh, and as well as by few tribes in Manipur. Because these native tribes, they feel that Chakmas and Hajongs are outsiders and they are being given citizenship status only on religious grounds. This is one of the reasons why there are massive protests in the northeastern parts of India against the Citizenship Amendment Bill. In its present form, the Citizenship Amendment Bill provides for citizenship status to refugees who belong to six religious communities, that is Hindus, Christians, Buddhists, Jains, Sikhs and Parsis. So refugees belonging to these six communities who are coming from Pakistan, Afghanistan and Bangladesh, they will be granted citizenship status as per the provisions of the Citizenship Amendment Bill of 2016. The bill has been currently passed by Lok Sabha and it is currently pending in the Rajya Sabha. And the bill has triggered a massive controversy in the northeastern parts of India because the native tribes and the local political organizations are opposed to these provisions because this will introduce refugees and migrants from these countries as it would alter the demography of the region. The issue of refugees and migrants has already led to socio-ethnic tensions in the northeastern parts of India, especially in states such as Assam, Mizoram, Tripura, etc. And since many political parties have withdrawn support to the Citizenship Amendment Bill, a joint parliamentary committee has been set up to review the provisions of the Citizenship Amendment Bill. And now the Chakmas have petitioned the Ministry of Home Affairs to even include the Chin refugees from Myanmar under the Citizenship Amendment Bill. The Chins are an ethnic group. They are found in the Arakan region of Myanmar. Even they have faced violence and persecution due to ethnic violence in Myanmar. The Joint Parliamentary Committee has already rejected giving the status of citizenship to refugees who are coming from Myanmar. But the Chakmas are basing their demand on the fact that the Chins are ethnically related to other local ethnic tribes in Mizoram and as well as in Manipur. Essentially, the Chakmas are trying to counter opposition in the northeastern states by including the Chins under the proposed changes, because the Chins are ethnically related to the Mizos and Kukis, who are the native tribes of northeastern states. And the Chakmas are basing their argument on a report published by Human Rights Watch, which is a global human rights organization. The report says that the Chins are facing massive violence and persecution at the hands of militant groups and ethnic groups in Myanmar. So this could be a valid ground for granting them citizenship status. But if you look at the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, the UNHCR, it has removed the refugee status, which was granted to the Chins because of the improved political climate in Myanmar. The UNHCR has said that the Chins no longer need any international protection and their refugee status has been revoked. The next article deals with the recent outbreak of the Zika virus disease in Rajasthan. This outbreak was studied by the National Institute of Virology and it falls under the Indian Council for Medical Research. So the study published by NIV Pune has established that the Zika virus outbreak in Rajasthan is not related to the Zika outbreak in Brazil, which occurred in 2015. The study has clearly established that the Rajasthan strain was an endemic strain, which means that the virus strain was prevalent in India and in Asia for a number of years. And as a result, this would have accorded herd immunity to the region which was affected by the virus outbreak. It means that people in the region have already been exposed to this strain of Zika virus which broke out in Rajasthan. It is not a new variant or a foreign variant which has come from Brazil. And due to its endemic nature and due to the previous exposure of the region, people in general would have developed immunity to the virus, and this would help limit any future outbreaks in India. So this finding of the National Institute of Virology contradicts the reports of the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, which were issued in November 2018. The Ministry of Health had claimed that the Rajasthan outbreak was connected to the Brazilian outbreak, and the ministry had also claimed that the Indian outbreak was not reported to cause microcephaly, which is a type of a birth defect associated with the Zika virus disease. So these findings are contradictory to the statements issued by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, and the article is asking the ministry to be cautious when it comes to issuing such reports in the future. Let's take up the next article. Greenpeace, which is a global NGO working in the field of environment protection conservation, has come out with a report which is critical of the recently launched scheme of the central government, that is the National Clean Air Program. The program was launched just a few weeks back, and we have covered this comprehensively in our news analysis. The National Clean Air Program has been started by the government of India with the intention of reducing particulate matter pollution in 102 cities. And the objective is to cut particulate matter pollution by 20 to 30% by the year 2024. And the report published by Greenpeace says that the selection of these 102 cities is based on the pollution data which was collected in 2015. And as a result, the data is outdated. On the other hand, Greenpeace has used the latest data available for 2017, and as per this data, there are 241 cities in India which have very high levels of particulate matter 10. The PM10 levels in these 241 cities is way above the standards prescribed under the National Ambient Air Quality Standards. And the Greenpeace report says that essentially 139 cities have been left out, because just 102 cities out of 241 have been included by the central government under the National Clean Air Program. So Greenpeace has suggested to the government that it should rely on the latest data available for 2017 instead of the outdated data of 2015. Currently, under the new program, the government is coming up with a customized program to target PM pollution in these 102 cities. The government will mainly focus on increasing monitoring stations, providing better technology support, and as well as in strengthening enforcement to contain air pollution in these 102 cities. Now let's take up a column from the editorial page. The column is written by Arun Maria, a former member of the Planning Commission. And the column deals with the topic of universal basic income. So first we need to understand what is meant by universal basic income, and then we shall discuss the arguments made by the author in the article. Universal basic income is currently a trending topic in India and as well as across the world. Under this model, the government is expected to make an unconditional periodic cash payment to every citizen, irrespective of one's employment status, irrespective of one's financial status, and irrespective of one's socio-economic status. Every citizen will be eligible for a periodic cash transfer from the state directly into our bank accounts. See, currently, the state is providing for human development by focusing on service delivery. The state generates a certain revenue by collecting taxes, and it spends this money in running a variety of welfare programs which are providing for basic services such as healthcare, education, food security, etc. But the government is facing a massive challenge here, because when it comes to service delivery, the government has to deal with the problem of targeting, because only certain sections are eligible for targeted service delivery under the current welfare programs. And the service delivery platform has become highly ineffective because of administrative inefficiency, because of corruption, and as well as due to lack of accountability. So under a universal basic income model, we will make a complete transition from the current model. Instead of the government focusing on service delivery, the government instead will directly make cash payment to the citizens, and the citizens in turn can access the basic services directly from the market, that is from the private service providers and as well as from the public service providers. So the concept of universal basic income definitely has some advantages. It will take away the problem of targeting. It will reduce our dependency on the government machinery, which has turned out to be ineffective and corrupt. And instead, the state can directly make cash transfers and the public can access the services directly from the market. But this arrangement is also fraught with a number of problems and disadvantages. First and foremost, does the state have enough money, enough revenue to provide for a basic income to everyone? Second, will the cash provided to the citizens, will it be sufficient for us to access all the required services? And third, is the quality of services provided by the private and the public service providers? So in this context, Arun Marya raises the question of India's GDP growth, which has been quite remarkable over the last 15 years. But he questions whether this GDP growth has really generated human development in the country. The author is asking whether the HDI index of the country has really improved on par with the improvement in our GDP numbers. If you compare India's human development indices with other countries and other regions of the world, India performs quite poorly when it comes to healthcare, education, and food security. The author says that India's human development in some regions is comparable to sub-Saharan Africa. In fact, our neighboring countries such as Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, and Bhutan, they perform better than India when it comes to certain indicators of human development. So the author is basically saying that the trickle-down theory has not really worked efficiently for India. The benefits of development has not trickled down from the rich to the poor. So due to the failure of trickle-down economics, the rural farmers, the landless citizens, and those who do not have social security and permanent jobs, they have been severely affected and they are not able to access even basic services. And this is where the author refers to the theories developed by modern economists who advocate a two-step solution for this problem. Modern economists are of the view that universal basic income will be one part of the solution, and second would be more privatization. Essentially, the idea is to transfer the revenue of the state directly to the people and ask the people to access the services from the industry, which has been largely privatized. So essentially, all the basic services will be delivered by the private sector, and the people can access these good quality services in a more efficient manner from the private sector itself. So this model is being propagated by economists in India and as well as across the world. But the author questions the viability of this model. Here the author refers to a very popular statement made by the former president of the United States, Mr. Ronald Reagan. Ronald Reagan had said that the government is not really the solution. Rather, the government is the problem. According to Ronald Reagan, the government tries to enter each and every domain of service delivery, and due to its inefficiency, due to corruption, due to lack of accountability and transparency, the government fails to deliver on these services and instead creates more problems and more inequality. So in this context, he had said that the government is actually the problem and not the solution. So the author says that the view of modern economists is based on the views of Ronald Reagan. But Arun Marya feels that this model may not be applicable and viable for India, because India cannot rely on the private sector to deliver the basic services. And the author also refers to Milton Friedman, a very popular thinker, who said that the business of business must be only business. That is, a private institution should be solely driven by the motive of profit. A private institution cannot take up the burden of subsidizing citizens. If the burden of delivering services that to subsidize services is shifted to the private sector, then the private institutions will definitely fail because they are no longer driven by the profit motive. Or rather, the primary motive of profit is being curbed by the intervention of the state. And Milton Friedman said that this model is a recipe for disaster because this would ensure the failure of service delivery and as well as the private enterprises in the country. And in this context, the author refers to the global economic conditions. He says that wages are going down across the world. Unemployment rates are increasing as well. Plus, we have the looming threat of the fourth stage of the industrial revolution, or also known as Industry 4.0. Because this stage of the industrial revolution, which is powered by automation and artificial intelligence, is expected to drive further unemployment and further reduction in wages. So this is where the author suggests a new model for economic development and human development. He says that instead of focusing on universal basic income, the government should focus on universal basic capital. Under the UBC model, the people are the owners of the wealth that they are generating. Essentially, people are the shareholders in an institution and as well as in the economy. This doesn't happen in our current economic system because currently we have a huge income divide and as well as a social divide, which is a direct outcome of the relationship between the rich and the poor. The rich are the ones who will determine the rules and the laws of the land. They can alter the laws to their favor and ensure that the lower sections of the community are still discriminated against. So no matter what support the state is giving to the vulnerable sections, the rich will continue to remain influential and powerful, and the poor will be left at the mercy of the state. Now similarly, if you look at an institution, you have the management and the working class, and the workers are always subjected to the whims and fancies of the management. So the author says that unless and until the poor and the working class are given a share in the society and in the institution, changes cannot happen to human development. That's the reason why he's advocating the universal basic capital model, under which the people are the owners of the wealth that they are generating. They are basically shareholders. And this is a model which is already followed in cooperative societies. He's advocating the cooperative model of economic development by taking up examples of successful institutions such as Amul, Seva and Grameen. He says that this model reduces the income and social divide and provides for equal shareholding and sharing of wealth amongst the people. So in the conclusion, the author is suggesting a three-step solution to improve India's human development index. First, he says that the state should focus on building its own capacity for service delivery. This is where he is asking for the full-fledged implementation of the recommendations of the Second Administrative Reforms Commission. Next, he is asking for an aggregation of all the small enterprises in the country to create medium and large-sized enterprises. And he is asking the state to provide for better representation for the workers in the industry. And finally, the last step is to shift from the discussion of universal basic income towards the universal basic capital model, which is currently trending in international policy circles. Now let's look at the next article. The United States and Taliban have confirmed that they have arrived at a draft peace deal to resolve the Afghan crisis. So this is a very big development in international relations. We have been tracking the ongoing peace negotiations from a number of weeks. So today, let's look at the background to this topic and as well as the current status. In 2001, the United States suffered one of the most horrific terror attacks in the form of the 9/11 attacks. The attacks were carried out by the Al-Qaeda terrorist outfit, which was sheltered in Afghanistan by the Taliban. The Taliban was the then government of Afghanistan, which was in power. and it refused to cooperate with the United States and the International Security Assistance Force, which was authorized by the UN to defeat the Al-Qaeda terrorist outfit. And since Taliban refused to cooperate with the United States, the US declared the Taliban as a hostile organization, and the NATO forces led by the United States carried out an invasion of Afghanistan under Operation Enduring Freedom. The objective of this invasion was to throw out the Taliban government from power and to target the terrorists belonging to Al-Qaeda. Initially, the US managed to achieve these objectives by defeating the Taliban and by setting up a civilian government to provide for administration in Afghanistan. The civilian government was backed by the United States, and this civilian government, which was recognized by the international community, was supposed to act as a bulwark against the return and the resurgence of the Taliban. So over the years, the Taliban groups have managed to stage a resurgence, and today the Taliban has emerged as one of the strongest players in the region. And the Taliban has waged an insurgency war against the international forces. They have especially targeted the United States and their soldiers, and hence the US has suffered very significant casualties in this conflict. If you look at the infographic shared here, you can see that the casualties have been rising significantly for the United States, and till date, the US has lost close to 4,260 soldiers in the Afghan conflict. So as a result, the war has become highly unpopular in the United States, and people are questioning the huge expenditure of billions of dollars by the US government on this war, and they are questioning the high number of American casualties in a foreign conflict. So due to the unpopularity of the war and the failed intervention of the American forces, the previous US government decided to draw down the troops, and former President Barack Obama initiated the policy of withdrawal of American troops from Afghanistan. But before the actual withdrawal, the US wanted to ensure that the Taliban is weakened and the civilian government should be strengthened. So President Obama ordered for an increase in deployment of troops in 2009 and 2010. Because the US believed that by deploying more troops on the ground, the Taliban could be defeated and the Afghan civilian government could be further strengthened. But unfortunately for the United States, things did not work out this way, and currently the US forces are under significant pressure by the Taliban groups. The Taliban also has managed to weaken the civilian government by a series of terror attacks against the Afghan government, and today Taliban has completed a complete resurgence in Afghanistan. If you look at the map shared over here, you can see the areas which are completely under the control of Taliban. Nearly 13% of Afghanistan today is completely controlled by Taliban. And the areas marked in orange, these are the areas where the Taliban has very, very significant influence. Its influence varies from 50 to 70% over Afghanistan. And very few areas marked in grey are under the control of the civilian government. This clearly shows that the Taliban has emerged as one of the strongest players, and today they are negotiating from a position of power. So due to these turn of events, the US has come to accept the Taliban as a stakeholder in the peace process. The irony is that the United States entered Afghanistan to defeat and remove the Taliban, but unfortunately today, they are negotiating with the same outfit in order to seek a face-saving exit from Afghanistan. Because this long drawn-out war has become a huge embarrassment for the United States, and the US-led war is considered as a failure because it has not managed to achieve its objectives. And Donald Trump, who took over from Obama, also has continued the same policy, because withdrawing American troops from foreign conflicts was one of the major promises made by the Trump presidential campaign. Recently, Trump has ordered the withdrawal of troops from Syria as well. And in order to accelerate the withdrawal of American forces from Afghanistan, the Trump government had appointed a special representative, Mr. Zalmay Khalilzad, who could lead the American negotiations with the Taliban. So over the last few weeks, the US representative has been negotiating with the Taliban leaders at Qatar. And finally, the two sides have confirmed the emergence of a draft peace deal. So according to this arrangement, the United States has promised to withdraw American troops over the next 18 months. The remaining 14,000 soldiers will be removed in a phased manner by the United States. But the US will carry out this withdrawal only if the Taliban commits not to allow Afghanistan to be used as a base for exporting terrorism. So this is the draft deal which has been reached by the United States and Taliban. And as you can see, it has clearly left out the Afghan civilian government. So it clearly shows that the US will accept the Taliban back into the government in some way or the other. There might be a power sharing deal which will be worked out. And through this, the Taliban leaders will come back to the Afghan government. And as a result, the civilian government, which is currently backed by India, might be weakened. Now let's look at the last article for the day. The Golden Langur Conservation Project of the state of Assam has been declared as a success. And this topic can be very important for prelims. We should basically look at the basic facts regarding Golden Langur. The Golden Langur is an ape species which is endemic to the northwest parts of Assam. And it is also found in few parts of Bhutan and as well as in Tripura. So this is an animal which is endemic to this particular region. And the IUCN has listed the Golden Langur as endangered. So this endangered species is currently under severe threat because of loss of habitat, and the Golden Langur Conservation Breeding Program was started in the state of Assam and it was funded by the Central Zoo Authority. Now let's take up the practice questions. In which state do we find the Upar River, which was recently in news? The correct answer is option A, Tamil Nadu. The Upar River is in news because of the protests in the Thoothukudi district of Tamil Nadu against the Sterlite industry of the Vedanta group. The Sterlite industry has been very controversial. It has caused massive pollution in the region and has led to very severe health consequences in the Thoothukudi district. And recently we have had reports about the Sterlite plant causing water pollution in the Upar River. That's the reason why the question has been picked. And the correct answer is option A, Tamil Nadu. Now let's take up a map-based question. Which of the following countries does not share a boundary or a border with Venezuela? The correct answer is option C, Bolivia. Let's look at the map here. This is where Venezuela is located in South America. As you can see, Brazil, Colombia and Guyana are immediate neighbors of Venezuela, whereas Bolivia is not a neighbor of Venezuela. It does not share a boundary with Venezuela. Now let's take up a question from the 2018 prelims paper. What is the consequence of a country becoming the member of the nuclear suppliers group? It will have access to the latest and most efficient nuclear technologies. That is a correct statement, because once you become a member of NSG, you can access the latest nuclear technology. Second, it automatically becomes a member of the non-proliferation treaty. This is a wrong statement. In fact, signing the NPT is a precondition to become a member of the NSG. Just by becoming a part of NSG, you will not automatically become a member of the NPT. So second one is a wrong statement and the right answer is option A. Finally, take up a mains practice question. What do you understand by the term universal basic income? Evaluate its viability in the Indian context. We have discussed this topic in great detail, so please write an answer to this question and post your answers in the comment section below. So that is it for the day. Thanks for watching.